In this video, we're going to cover turbo basics, specifically about our DPS turbochargers that fit in the Dodge Cummins, which are based upon the S300 and S400 platform turbos. Our goal in this video is to merely break it down in an easy to understand way so that if you need to get a turbocharger for your diesel, that you will at least understand the different sizes and some of the terminology and a little bit more about what you're doing. So first off, we're going to start with the sizing. For instance, this turbo right here is a 626512. It's an S300 style turbo, so it can also be called an S362 or an S362-6512 or a 6265.70. The 62, or that first number, that is the size of the compressor wheel. It's a 62 millimeter compressor wheel. That wheel is located right there. So this is the two wheels, the compressor wheel and the turbine or exhaust wheel on the shaft right here. And that 62 is measuring the small side. The small side, or the inducer, is where the air comes in. And the large side of the wheel is called the exducer. The second number, the 65, is the turbine wheel size. The turbine wheel is also called the exhaust wheel because it's located on the hot side of the turbo where the exhaust goes through. On the turbine side, the measurement is taken from the exducer, which is a small end of the turbine wheel. The exhaust comes in, the inducer is the big side on this one, where the inducer is the little side on this one. So on a 626512, the turbo is merely a 62 millimeter compressor wheel, a 65 millimeter turbine wheel, and the third number, the 12, is the turbine housing size, which is the size of the housing from the inlet to the radius of the center of the turbine wheel. It's a little complicated, but basically, the larger the number, the bigger the housing. The smaller the number, the smaller the housing. The turbine housing's AR has a huge impact on the turbo's efficiency and spool up. Generally speaking, a larger AR will hurt or slow down spool up time, but will increase top end performance. Whereas a smaller AR will improve spool up time, but it's going to reduce top end performance. So a 12 housing such as this is really a 0.70 AR, and a 14 housing would be a 0.80 AR. Okay, so now let's take a look at the compressor wheels. So we mentioned before that the compressor wheel is on a shaft that hooks it to the turbine wheel. This turbine wheel or exhaust wheel, as exhaust comes in, it spins it, which in turn spins the compressor wheel as well, and that forces air into the engine. Right here, we have a 62 millimeter cast wheel. We have a 64 millimeter cast wheel and a 66 millimeter cast wheel. We also have a 66 millimeter billet wheel. So if we look at them, you'll see the billet is more shiny and it has these machine marks. This is actually one of our forged milled billet wheels. It is made through a forging then
CNC machining process.
Whereas a cast wheel is an aluminum casting, a billet wheel can be more efficient if it is machined correctly. The machining and forging process makes the billet wheel more durable than the cast wheel. Either style, however, works well on a diesel.
Okay, so this 626512 could also be, you know, it could be changed to like a 6271 or 12, or it could be like a 647112 or a 66. It's just the size of the wheel. You understand that now. But this right here is a third gen style turbo. You know that because of how the compressor housing is. Compressor housings, or compressor covers are called sometimes. This one goes to a second gen. The first gen does the same thing. They come out straight. The inlet is here where the air comes in from the air filter. Then the outlet goes to the intercooler. It comes out straight. On the third gen style, you'll see it doesn't come out straight like that. It comes out forward. It has a 90 degree elbow already cast into it. This is a normal S300 style. Now this right here is our special DPS race housing style, which we put on all of our turbos and we put on all of our compound kits. And what's special about this is if you notice up here, it has a race housing. See the difference between the tops there where the air comes in from the air filter?
This is our patented design with our unique ported shroud, which allows inlet air to enter more efficiently. In fact, 9% more efficiently.
It also has these barbs, see, multiple barbs put on So when you connect the couplers to it, they stay on, they clamp on well. If you look close, there's one more difference. The outlet bends tighter towards the center so it fits like stock and has better clearance in our compounds.
Okay, so on the compressor cover, you'll notice this one has this little brass fitting here. This fitting, and this one right here, just has a plug in it, so you could take that out. It's so that on the turbo, you can have a wastegate. This right here is where the wastegate is located on the turbo, right here. This is the actuator. So this little fitting allows air to go through the hose here and go to this exhaust, it goes to this actuator that allows it to, when it hits a certain boost, it's a spring in there, it pushes it open and allows
the wastegate to open and exhaust to bypass the turbine. Now let's talk about wastegates.
This right here is merely just a turbine or exhaust housing. As you can see, this is on the turbo and this is just it all by itself. Well, right here, this is a wastegated housing and this is a non-gated.
If you notice, the non-gated one does not have a metal plate on the side. This one does not have a wastegate. It is a non-gated housing. The wastegate housing has this little arm that moves back and forth and links the wastegate to the actuator.
We've cut one open for you so you can actually see what it looks like. This right here is this portion of the housing, you can see. And so this right here is the arm, and what happens is the wastegate actuator takes in pressure here, and there's a little spring in there. We'll show you the inside of the actuator here in a minute. When that hits a certain pressure, it will push open these wastegate pucks. If you look, you can see there's two holes there these pucks go over. Now, sometimes people can't build boost and there's a problem. Well, what you can do if you're not building boost on your turbo and you have a wastegate on there, you just take out these five bolts, you unloosen them and you take this plate off so you can see inside here. This should be held, these pucks should be held tight against the turbo housing like that. If they're loose or these are broken, then you have a broken wastegate.
And that happens quite a bit if people loosen the wastegate too much. It can open too wide and hit the metal cover, which will damage the pucks, destroying the valve seal, and then you have a rough time building boost. A wastegate is a valve device that regulates pressure by allowing a certain amount of exhaust to bypass the turbine wheel. Basically, it's a bypass valve and a passage within the turbine housing that allows excess exhaust pressure to bypass the turbine and go downstream into the exhaust. The wastegate improves the exhaust flow by 10 to 15%. It allows the turbo to have a smaller AR turbine housing, so it will spool up quickly, but still flow like a slightly larger exhaust housing. A wastegated turbo is desirable for most applications. This is what's called a pneumatic or a mechanical actuator. As boost pressure builds, it goes through this hose and pushes against the spring inside the actuator. Doing this moves the rod and the arm, which opens the valves and diverts exhaust. By diverting exhaust from the turbine wheel speed is regulated, which in turn also regulates the rotating speed of the compressor wheel. This is how a wastegate controls boost pressures. So by turning and shortening this rod, we can make the turbo build more boost because it will cause it to wastegate later. Vice versa, lengthening the rod will make the turbo build less boost because it will wastegate earlier. As we mentioned before, be careful not to loosen the rod too much. When this is loosened too much, these pucks can open too far and break the valve device, thus making it so it is always an open valve, which will kill your ability to make boost. While we're still talking about turbine housings, on this turbo, we have an S300 T3 gated housing, and here is just the housing alone. This is an S400 T4 gated housing, and this is a non-gated T6 S400 housing that would go like on a semi. Here we also have our DPS S400 T4 turbinator VGT turbine housing with the pivoting stator vanes that can continually adjust by opening and closing. This three-stage actuator works really well on the VGT because rather than just having one spring cover the entire boost curve like a normal mechanical actuator,
It has three different stages and three sizes of springs that engage at different points, making it possible for our VGT to effectively follow and cover the entire natural boost curve of the turbo. So the turbinator can produce ultimate performance on the spool up, mid-range, and high boost. This is our patented turbinator VGT housing with our proprietary three-stage mechanical actuator. And here is the normal mechanical actuator, which is only a one stage. Side by side, you can see the differences between the two. Running the VGT turbinator with the three-stage actuator will significantly improve boost and power throughout the entire turbo boost curve, which means you'll see an improvement in mileage, responsiveness, EGT control, and power. Later on, we'll fully cover our turbinator VGT in greater detail. That's all we have time for now. In our next episodes, we'll cover the different factory turbos, including the Holset VGT that comes stock with the 6.7 Cummins, as well as many other turbo basics.